Welcome to the Alex Jones Show on this Wednesday, August 5th, 2015. I'm David Knight, your host. We'll be having reports as well as a call-in from Alex Jones reporting on his investigation of the globalist takeover of Europe. He is now in Italy. There's a lot of news today. We have a new, not a new Planned Parenthood video. Of course, there was a fifth video released yesterday, but we have a video that I think is very telling in a number of ways that revolves around this issue of the Planned Parenthood expose. We have a headline at InfoWars.com. Brainwashed CNN host asks Planned Parenthood video maker if he's a violent extremist. Well, I would say, first of all, she's not a brainwashed host. I don't agree with that terminology. I think she is a host who is actively involved in brainwashing people. But when they use the term violent extremists, we should understand what's behind that. We just had a couple of weeks ago, and I knew this was coming. I was very concerned about what I saw with Wesley Clark, where he was floating the trial balloon saying we need to identify people who could become extremists. We need to identify people who might become violent extremists. And we need to say to them, you have a right of free speech, but we also have a right to protect ourselves, and we'll lock you up before you do anything. You understand? That's pre-crime. You understand how dangerous that is. And at the same time, he's floating that trial balloon, Wesley Clark, former general, former Democrat candidate for president. We also have a GOP congressman, McCall, offering a new bill that sailed through the first committee hearing. It's going to go to the floor. It's going to be coming up. It was unanimously passed through with a voice vote. They said, yeah, this is not controversial at all. And what it does is it creates a new division of Homeland Security to combat violent extremism. So what is this CNN host who's defending the murder of innocent children, the sale of body parts, accuse this guy who's doing investigations of being a violent extremist? He's taking videos. He's not violent. He's taking videos. They're the ones who are violent. We need to understand what's behind this political labeling of people to lock them up without due process. That is going to be under FEMA, under Homeland Security. We're also going to be looking at a new biolab that is being built in Kansas. There's a lot of concern, a lot of concern about accidents that have been that have happened at the biolabs in Kansas, the University of Kansas, in terms of research that they've done. But now they're building a massive new lab. Over $1 billion is going to be spent on this, and the people in the area are very concerned because the government is going to be bringing in deadly pathogens and doing agricultural research on these deadly pathogens. These are things that the CDC calls select agents, things that can be used as bioweapons, things that are very deadly if they get out. And of course, what's the point of this research? They do gain of function research on these select agents. In other words, they want to make them more deadly, more easy to spread. We've already seen these pathogens get out at the National Primate Lab in Tulane. They brought in a pathogen that is not indigenous to the United States. As a matter of fact, it's only found in one country in the world. It occasionally occurred in one other area of the world, but that's it. It's not spreading, but it was endemic in those two countries. They brought that deadly pathogen in. They experimented with it in a bio level safety, three level lab. And it got out, and they don't know how it got out. It's in the wild there in Louisiana. We've had this kind of thing happen before. Many people believe that's the origins of Lyme disease. Why are we doing this kind of insane behavior? We're also going to be talking to Lionel. He's going to be joining us later in the show. We have some interesting questions to ask him, legal questions, investigative questions about what's going on with Planned Parenthood, also with the issue of pre-crime. Stay with us. It's going to be an interesting show. We're going to be joined by Alex Jones, the former special reporter. He's also going to be Skyping in. He's, of course, now investigating the globalist takeover of Europe. He's going to be calling in with a special report on that. We also have Lionel coming in the third hour. We're going to talk to him about some of the hot issues of the day. I know he was on RT talking about the pre-crime aspects that are involved in these troubling comments that we've seen from Wesley Clark, the troubling legislation that we've seen from Representative McCall here in Texas, creating a department under Homeland Security, under FEMA, that is going to identify people who have the potential to become violent extremists. And of course, do something about it before they do anything. That's called pre-crime, folks. That's called locking people up before they do anything, just on suspicion. Why does it not surprise us then that we see this investigation, this interview by CNN accusing the fellow who made the Planned Parenthood and did the investigation, did the videos? Why did they call him a violent extremist? Why did they try to pin that on him? Look, we need to understand where all these things eventually come around. We saw the RICO statutes initially applied to organized crime. Then they applied them to people who were abortion protesters. So we're going to talk about that. But first, I want you to see this video. We've got a lot of different news today, but I want to get to this video first because this ties in a lot of things. It's not just the government ignoring what's going on with Planned Parenthood on the Democrat side. It's not the media ignoring it, but now they're going on the offensive, accusing someone essentially of being a terrorist, using the same term of art, a violent extremist, that they've been floating with legislation and with trial balloons from Wesley Clark, former Democrat presidential candidate, former general, as well as a Republican offering legislation to create a new department in Homeland Security inside of FEMA to implement what he's talking about. Identifying people. That's why they look at your social media. That's why we have the geospatial intelligence. That's why we have things like unconventional warfare exercises, folks. This is where this all leads. Identifying people, putting all of your information into their artificial intelligence programs, and then seeing who pops up, making them the target of the investigation and doing something about it. So let's play this interview here, and we're going to do this in two parts. Let's go to the first part, guys.
Planned Parenthood also hasn't produced any evidence that they have any real costs associated with the supply of aborted fetal tissue, especially when they're partnered with a middleman biotech company like Stem Express or Novogenix or ABR that sends technicians into the clinics to do the harvesting, to identify the patients, to receive the fetuses, dissect the specimens, ship them off. That's all.
And exactly, that's what we have seen before. Hang on with that. Hold that right there. Pause that. Can you pause that? Yeah. Novogenix, when we had the Lambo lady, the one who was talking about, yeah, I want to make a lot of money. I want to get a Lamborghini. Okay, that's a joke, but it's not a joke that they make this much money. It's not a joke what they're doing to children. And what she said to them was, she said, we have somebody from Novogenix who comes in. She comes into the clinic. She looks at the aborted babies. She doesn't call it that. She calls it the fetal tissue of this. She selects what she wants, and she takes it with her. We don't have to do anything. It's very, very easy for us, very, very profitable for us, in other words, okay? That's the issue. Are they doing something that they're getting compensated for? That would be the gray area on this. But she admitted, and he was pointing out in that clip, that that's not what's involved here. Continue on with that clip.
Are absorbed by other outside biotech companies, yet Planned Parenthood is still receiving payments per specimen that they produce.
David, I want to stop you there because we did ask Planned Parenthood about that, about your claims, and we also asked Stem Express, and both of them say that you're wrong. They say that there are the only costs that Planned Parenthood gets are the costs for transfer. If it involves storage, if it involves the time that it takes for a staff member to get consent from a patient. In fact, let me read to you the statement that Stem Express gave us about this very thing. Stem Express does not pay Planned Parenthood clinics or any other healthcare provider for fetal tissue. Stem Express reimburses Planned Parenthood clinics and other healthcare providers for their reasonable costs associated with the tissue procurement process, such as those incurred in connection with storage, processing, documentation, and staff participation. So now here are two different organizations, Planned Parenthood and the middleman that you're talking about, saying that they're not being paid for the sale of fetal tissue.
Yeah, I think it's really cute that they have their story straight and that they're covering up for each other. But I mean, what I think that the next question that the media should be asking of Stem Express and Planned Parenthood is, if you go to our website, centerformedicalprogress.org, we have an advertisement from Stem Express that was an advertisement for Planned Parenthood clinics to tell them that they could make a financial profit, that they could have fiscal growth to their clinics, that it would be a financial benefit to the Planned Parenthood clinics if they partnered with Stem Express to supply aborted fetal tissue. And that advertisement was endorsed by one of Planned Parenthood's medical directors, Dr. Dorothy Ferguson. So I'm not sure how that flyer that Stem Express has been passing out to Planned Parenthood clinics squares with the statement that they just gave you.
Yeah. So in other words, they're putting out a flyer that says that you can make a lot of money selling your tissue to us. That's Stem Express putting out. But then they say, well, Planned Parenthood isn't making any profit. They're just recovering some of their costs. Two different stories. And you hear one story from them, and then you hear another story when they know, when they don't think anybody is watching them. You know, we talked to Doug Hagman yesterday, and he is a licensed investigator in multiple states. He's worked with the FBI and with others in terms of investigations of criminal activity. This is not a conspiracy theory. This is not a hoax. This is not entrapment. There are people who are saying that this is being done by Planned Parenthood. It was, there were questions about what was being done. This wasn't a complete setup. They didn't come in and say, well, you know, why don't you think of doing this? This is something, obviously, they've been doing for quite some time. They're talking about how they did it. They're talking about how they had people previously that they've been contracting with. This is how they do it. We don't have to do anything, which means they have no cost. That's what they're telling people in this investigation. All investigations are done like this. This is not entrapment. This is not a cleverly edited video. You can see how long they dialogue about this. Let's go to the next clip, because this is where it gets, I think, even more sinister.
Your critics of your organization, I should say that you're not journalists, as you purport to be on your website, but rather you're violent extremists. They say that you are operating under the guise of investigative reporting, but really you're trying to shut down all Planned Parenthoods and women's access to things like birth control and other services that they provide. Do you have any ties to Operation Rescue?
So a couple of things there. First, number one, I'm not a violent person, and I never have been, and I never will be. Troy Newman is one of the board members of the Center for Medical Progress,
and Troy is Newman a good is friend the president of Operation Rescue. That does have, I mean, Operation Rescue does have a history of threatening violence against abortion clinics.
You know, I don't think that's true at all. You'd have to talk to Troy specifically about about the full history of Operation Rescue and some of those details, but I don't think that's a fair characterization at all. As far as the second point, ultimately the 2.5 year long investigative journalism study that the Center for Medical Progress conducted about Planned Parenthood's sale of fetal tissue, ultimately that's about exposing to the public the reality of how Planned Parenthood conducts their fetal tissue sales and what their relationship with companies like Stem Express is like. It's not an issue of the rest of Planned Parenthood services or whether or not those are a good thing. It's specifically about showing the public exactly how those sales work and documenting those in a way that everybody can see.
Precisely. But this is how it's going to be used. This is the pre-crime aspect. This is the incrimination by the media. What she's doing to him is exactly what Glenn Beck did to the Bundys when he had him on his program and they said, are you a sovereign citizen? These are terms they've created, terms of art that they use to not only assassinate people, but they're going to be used to lock people up. Now, he didn't know what that meant, and I'm sure that David Daleiden doesn't understand that this violent extremist is a term of art that's being used. He says, of course we're not violent. I mean, the people that they were recording were the ones who were violent, but they were just doing an investigation. There was nothing at all violent about that. There's absolutely no justification for her to accuse him of that. But that's what is behind this. You need to be aware of how they're bringing this out. You need to be aware of the trial balloons of Wesley Clark. You need to be aware of the GOP legislation, because the GOP is ready to sacrifice every one of your rights on the altar of state security. And that's not going to make you any safer. That's going to have you living under an authoritarian government. Let's look at an example. Many of you may have heard of a pastor called Randy Alcorn. He's not a pastor anymore, but he is a writer. He's done a lot of Christian fiction books, very popular. He's made millions and millions of dollars with these books that he writes, but he hasn't earned a cent. And there's a reason for this. He refuses to take the money because he lost in a lawsuit. They came after him with a lawsuit. They've come after others with RICO statutes. People who were passive protesters, people who stood outside an abortion clinic with signs like many of us at InfoWars did when we organized that protest at the local abortion clinic. They would get judgments against people. In the case of Randy Alcorn, back in 1989, Portland police had arrested him several times for blocking the doors of abortion clinics. One of the clinics had sued him and other rescuers, quote unquote. They want a small judgment plus attorney fees. He refused to pay on principle. He said it would violate his conscience to write a check to an abortion clinic. Now, he had already placed his assets, his home, his car, other things, in his wife's name. And he was not going to pay that judgment. But they came after him, even garnishing his wages. So he resigned as a pastor. He has made millions of dollars in royalties, and he has refused to turn a cent over. That's the way they will come after you. And they will use the RICO statutes. They will use these new statutes against violent extremists, against anyone that they consider to be a political enemy. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Alex Jones is going to be joining us with a special report in the next segment, Operation Chaos. And of course, we have a global immigration crisis. It's by design. That's the words of the Home Secretary. She didn't say it was by design. She said it was a global immigration crisis. That was the Home Secretary of the UK working with her French counterpart to try to stop the massive influx of criminal immigrants through the channel coming from Calais into the UK. And of course, we can see this in the United States as well. It's one of the reasons why Donald Trump has peaked in the campaign polls is because he's spoken the truth about this that the rest of those in government will not talk about. We're going to talk about that in just one moment. Of course, we're going to have a special report from Alex Jones in the next segment. We also have Lionel coming up in the third hour to talk to us. Today, we have a flash sale of DNA Force. This is 30% off of DNA Force, and it is only for 24 hours. One of the biggest savings you're going to find, because not only is it one of our top-of-the-line products, it is a hardcore product, one of the most hardcore products from InfoWars Life, yet it's loaded with BioPQQ compound, backed by 175 clinical studies, contains more potent antioxidant activity than vitamin C. A very high-quality, very expensive premium item, and you can get that now. DNA Force, 30% off for just 24 hours, a flash sale. And of course, everything at the InfoWarsLife.com store is available this week. We've extended the free shipping for July. We've extended that one more week as a thank you to those who support our operation. So everything you get at InfoWarsLife.com is free shipping this week. Now, in a quick news flash before we get back to the other stories that we were talking about, there's one more thing I wanted to say about the Planned Parenthood situation. But there have been more shots fired on soldiers in Mississippi. This happened yesterday around Camp Shelby. There was a heightened state of alert yesterday after there were shots fired. People believe that it was a white male in a red or maroon pickup truck. And today it has happened again. Mississippi Governor Phil Bryant said, "This is one of the reasons I recently signed an executive order directing certain National Guard personnel to be armed." However, he cannot arm the regular military. And as we all know from the Fort Hood shootings, from the shootings at the recruitment stations, the Pentagon has disarmed our soldiers at the bases. They're not allowed to protect themselves. Only the MPs are allowed to have arms. The rest of them are locked up on bases. So far, no injuries have been reported in either incident. It's a very concerning situation because we have to be concerned about it if it's legitimate. We also have to be concerned about it if it's a false flag because of the military operations that are going on with Jade Helm and other things. This is what many people were concerned that there might be some kind of a false flag attack. And of course, in either instance, whether it's legitimate or whether it's a false flag, people could really die with this. A very dangerous situation there. Again, for a second day, shots have been fired in Mississippi. Now, we were just talking about Planned Parenthood, and before I went on, I just wanted to talk one more time about this article that was up at InfoWars.com yesterday about Obama speaking out against organ harvesting of African albinos. Now, he's concerned about that, the practice that's happening in Africa, where they are killing babies and taking their body parts, harvesting their organs in a ritualized killing because they're albinos. And yet, he completely ignores the massive harvesting of organs by Planned Parenthood. Absolutely stunning to see that. But here's something else that came up. Ashley Judd has taken to Twitter to defend the Planned Parenthood practices. And this is what she tweeted out. She said, "My well woman healthcare provider, thank you always, Planned Parenthood. That's where she goes to get her health care, she says. And some of the people had some real biting comments. One of them said, if you want health care next to the room where they're rummaging through baby parts, okay, but I'm not paying for it. Another one said, women's health? What BS? I'm 66. I have never walked through your doors. I go to a doctor's office. You belong in a prison. And another one says, really? Times must be tough for Harvard grads and movie stars as well, right? She's trying to tell us that she can't get health care if they shut down funding, government funding to Planned Parenthood. And of course, the bills to defund Planned Parenthood would say they're still going to fund women's clinics, but not any women's clinics that perform abortion. That's the difference. That's where we should draw the line. I don't think that anybody should have a problem with not funding something that is at least as controversial as this. But of course, they want to close their eyes and they want to go on the attack, accusing anyone who exposes this practice of being a violent extremist. And you know what's behind that. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
When you go see James Bond movies or when you watch silly TV shows from the 60s like Get Smart, and you see organizations named Spectre or Chaos, you can see things happening in the real world and make a joke out of it, but it's not funny. Those films and those comedies are reflecting what really goes on in the real world. Now, we're dubbing what I'm about to break down Operation Chaos, but I bet you my right arm, and it's a safe bet, that within the internal NATO, DARPA, Ford Foundation, Council on Foreign Relations, globalist think tanks, that it's called something like Operation Destabilization or Operation Chaos. Because I've read so many of the other documents, I've covered it in films like The Obama Deception, Fall of the Republic, Endgame, where we get the North American Union minutes when Judicial Watch sued and got them, and they're there saying, we will use crises for stealth integration of the NAU into the Atlantic Treaty and the TPP. That's an eight-year-old film. Now TPP is popularly understood to be corporate domination. But a decade ago, 20 years ago, people were not aware of it. So that's the positive news. But what is Operation Chaos? Again, that's our name for it, but that's what it is. A rose is still a rose by any other name. And people need to get their minds wrapped around it. This is planned. And that's why whether it's happening in France or whether it's happening in the UK or whether it's happening in Italy or whether it's happening in Greece, it is the same thing over and over again. The same thing in the U.S. Southwest. And that is the people bomb. The focused masses of 6+ billion third world people that are pouring in and being given economic amnesty as economic refugees and are then being put on welfare, are allowed to have their babies paid for free, are given everything, and then filled full of liberation theology that they deserve everything for free and that the indigenous populations of Europe are bad people that need to turn everything they've got over to them. It is wild. So out of my research trip to the UK, to Spain, now to Italy, what we read in the newspapers is conservatively 5-10 times worse than what we thought. There are more foreigners, it seems like, in Rome and other cities around Rome, same thing with Barcelona and Spain and Valencia, where we traveled, than there are Spanish or there are Italians. And the foreigners are aggressive. They are involved in much of the crime, and they are entitled. Look at this article out of the International New York Times from yesterday. Now, the New York Times itself calls this a huge crisis. In fact, I've got my notes right here. Let me give you the exact quote. The New York Times calls it a full-scale disaster. I wrote notes here. A full-scale disaster. And why is it a full-scale disaster? They've already moved in giant immigrant populations who then are allowed to vote, who are allowed to hold government office in the EU and the U.S. I'm going to cover that in a moment. It's being celebrated in the New York Times that illegal aliens are being appointed to major commissions in California to run things. When you look at all this, it's an organized plan. If you give the illegals free health care, babies can be had for free, all these goodies, when no other countries in the world allow this but the West, you will bring in larger populations of people fleeing their collapsing nations. So the big major corporations on record destabilize Africa, destabilize the Middle East, destabilize these different regions so that they're economically in bad shape so they can buy it up cheap, get the resources cheap. They use Western money to back our militaries to do this. But then do we get the booty? Do we get the spoils? I'm not endorsing invading these countries for spoils, but we don't even get them. We pay for it. The globalists then get the spoils. They're always selling it like the West somehow is sucking off a third world. It's the other way around. The people of the West are the ones that basically are fitting the bill when you actually look at the numbers. So Operation Chaos is meant to bankrupt Europe, bankrupt the United States, bankrupt Canada, bankrupt Australia, and then we're all conquered. And then it's game over because the elitists themselves live behind walled cities, like over at the Vatican, that's above the law, diplomatic immunity, for 15 years straight, won't even pay its power bill to the city of Rome. And the city of Rome dare not turn the power off to the Vatican. I mean, that's above the law when the power lines run into Vatican City, a third the size of Rome, and they don't even pay for the power bill. Above the law, don't pay for the power bill, just like the UN above the law. And the U.S. basically pays for half the bills of the U.N., about 50%. It's this same globalist model where the Pope's lecturing middle-class people to pay more taxes and to pay carbon taxes to the central banks and social welfare and social justice and open the borders up and do all this when he lives behind a walled city and is above the law and the Vatican, one of the richest institutions in the world, estimated to have over $100 trillion in land assets alone. That's mainstream news. $100 trillion in land around Rome. It seems like every other building is owned by them. Tax exempt, above the law, pissing on everybody, doing whatever they want. And I'm not bashing Catholics. I'm bashing this above the law institution over here, just like the UN, just like the city of London within London, just like DC is above the law, doesn't pay taxes, just like all these billionaires don't pay taxes, but they're the biggest recipients of banker bailouts like Warren Buffett. It's an above the law class warfaring with giant third world populations saying sick 'em on the middle class that buys purses, that buys cars, that stays at hotels, that has 15, 20, 30, 40, 50 employees. They don't want a real economy under Agenda 21. It's their stated mission to shut off your economy. But to bring in their control, they need Operation Chaos. The New York Times admits 107,000 illegals that they call refugees out of Africa and the Middle East in just the first 6 months of 2015 to one island, Lesbos, where the legend of the beautiful women comes from. And the lesbians are angry. And I don't mean two women together. I'm saying the people that live on the beautiful island of Lesbos that has had 107,000 registered by the UN people wash ashore, and it's got them bitching and complaining, saying, I've been in here for days. I want my welfare. I want my hotel. I want out of here. And they let them out. They don't deport hardly any of them. They sign them up for welfare. As Greece itself is imploding and many Grecian people are on the street, many Greeks are on the street, and their system is collapsing, this is what's happening. This is the chaos. And then their answer is, we'll control the borders, pay more taxes, let the EU get rid of what's left of your sovereignty, while the EU Commission that's unelected, look it up. Just type in, EU Commission demands quotas for more migrants. Don't call them illegals. Call them migrants. Call them refugees. And I'm not against these poor people. If I lived in North Africa in a hellhole, I'd want to move to Italy. I want to move here already. I mean, it's nice. But Italy, Greece, all these places are collapsing into debt that's untenable. This is Operation Chaos. And then meanwhile, in the very same New York Times, this is just one newspaper, and we're seeing it here on the ground, they admit that horrible Greeks are protesting and horrible Italians are protesting, that in the nicest middle-class neighborhoods, they're bussing the illegals in that get here on rafts and bring them into their neighborhoods and then ordering everyone to just to submit to them. And so they're calling it racist that the Italians and the Greeks don't like it. Now, that's in the same article. And meanwhile, it's also bad. The LA Times reports, if you don't like the two illegal aliens now appointed in California in Huffington Park, they're undocumented, let me use the proper word, to now run the undocumented program. So there you go. And they say because they're uniquely qualified to get city taxpayer money as felons and to do all this. I mean, this is a revolution of the ultra rich, pressure from above, and the ultra poor, pressure from below. This is a total and complete takeover with the big corporations and the giant 6.5+ billion people that live outside the few wealthy industrialized nations. This is a total takeover. And it is just mind-blowing to physically see it, because I don't speak Italian, but I was able to look up the groups, and we actually have some video of this we're going to put in a produced report, probably when we get back, because I've shot so much footage. I see people throwing plastic bottles at the police, yelling. There's probably about 500 protesters. And I thought it was some leftist group until I went and looked it up, and it was a group, just a workers group, traditionally leftist, that is upset about the open borders and upset about losing their jobs. So this isn't going to help the third world bringing everybody in and collapsing the wages. It's going to turn the West into the third world. And this is the plan. This is the program. This is organized chaos. And you notice free welfare in the U.S. brings the illegals in, the train loads, the bus loads, the Border Patrol secretly shipping them in. Same thing here. Government continuing the smuggling process. And hell, if Europeans are this bad thing for all the horrible stuff that Europe has invented and all the horrible things Europe has done. Actually, Europe's done a lot of horrible things, but look at every other country's done it as well. Every other group's done the same stuff or worse. Is there anywhere Europeans are allowed to be? I mean, if we're not supposed to be in North America, and we're not supposed to be in Asia, we're not supposed to be in Africa, could Europeans please be here if we're so hellish and so bad and so exploitive? Why does everyone have to come here and then put everyone down? Because the ultra-rich are involved in class warfare, and they're the ones pushing racial divide, racial ideas, racial infighting. That's the key to this. The eugenicists know this will actually make Europeans become tribal and become racist and then be controlled by the globalists that, again, help create the crisis. And that's the key here. Just like prison wardens all over the world control prisons by race. Those are the best-run prisons. Black, white, Hispanic, Asian. And they promote the fact that everything's racially based because it's divide and conquer. So at every level, bankrupt the economy, bring in the illegals to do it. Drive down the wages, bring in the illegals to do it. Bring in the illegals to vote illegally to checkmate the indigenous populations. More divide and conquer. Pay for it all. Demonize anybody that doesn't go along with it. This is how they're operating. And it is a giant program of destabilization. It is Operation Chaos. Now, in the coming days, we're going to be covering the Vatican in depth. We're going to be going in. Documenting, talking to locals around the Vatican. We're going to be talking to some experts. We're going to be looking more at the economic implosion that's taking place. We are not here demonizing these poor people from the third world. We're only pointing out that globalization has engineered the full collapse of their society, then with a conduit to bring them in to further the chaos economy, the problem reaction solution economy. Alex Jones reporting from Rome, Italy. More is coming. Back to David Knight in the InfoWars News Center in Austin, Texas.
Exactly. And as Alex was pointing out, we have a global immigration crisis. That's what Theresa May, the UK Home Secretary, said. Her approach was to stop subsidizing immigration. Every other country, even places like Belize, not a first world country, you have to prove before you can become a citizen, a resident of that country, that you are able to support yourself and anyone that you bring with you. Even in Belize, not just in places like Switzerland, we're the only ones who are not only extending welfare benefits to any and everyone who wants to come here with or without legal permission. We are doing it at a higher rate than we do, giving them better benefits than we do people who are American citizens, giving in-state tuition to immigrants, illegal immigrants, regardless of where they go, where they live. They can go to any state and get in-state tuition. No citizen can do that. Giving them legal immunity as if they were ambassadors when they commit crimes. Look at these two reports. Of course, this one was mentioned by Alex in that report you just heard about the Huntington Park Council appoints two undocumented immigrants as commissioners, illegal aliens. They're now being appointed by the as commissioners on city advisory boards. We're giving people who are not citizens of this country, who have not grown up in this country, who have not adopted our system of government, have taken no oath of loyalty to the Constitution, maybe don't even understand it. We're giving them the right to vote. We're putting them on city council, city advisory boards as commissioners. This is absolutely insane. But we're also giving them legal immunity as criminals. As I've mentioned before, I went to the Austin council meeting. I saw the Democrat Party attacking a black Democrat sheriff, saying, "You're in the wrong party," because he was supporting the Secure Communities Initiative, which would essentially take someone that has a previous criminal record and turn them over to ICE. They said, "Well, you could have a criminal record just because you came into the country illegally." Yeah. Yeah. That's a criminal record, but you could also be a dangerous criminal. And when they take away the Secure Communities Initiative, they are letting all the criminals, violent and nonviolent, out. Look at this particular example. This is from Breitbart. Alleged child molester kept his dreamer amnesty despite risk designation. This is a California camp counselor charged with child molestation, distribution of child pornography. He was able to maintain his deferred action for childhood arrivals, DACA, because this guy is no child. He is a child molester. He is a child pornographer. He is an adult. But of course, Obama's DACA, deferred action for childhood arrivals, that goes up to people who are 31 years old. They still consider them to be children. That's our childish notions that we have in this country. So he was able to maintain his status and his job prior to his arrest, despite being considered a potentially egregious public safety risk. Chuck Grassley, Judiciary Committee Chairman, Senator Chuck Grassley, asked these questions of the immigration services. He said, are you aware that he was under investigation for child molestation? And it turns out that various agencies were. And he got his dreamer status, even though he was under investigation for child molestation and child pornography. See, it is not about eight-year-olds with their teddy bears at the border. In spite of what people from Glenn Beck to MSNBC will tell you, it is not about that. He went down to the border with his teddy bears, handing out hot dogs or whatever. Baloney. You're not going to make that trip through all the way through Mexico with all the violence there because of the drug cartels. You're not going to make that trip as an eight-year-old. Somebody is bringing you in. In many cases, these people are being brought in as slaves to a sex trade. That's the reality of this. But of course, people play along with that illusion. Before we go to some other news, I just want to let you know that we still have the special buy two silver bullet, get two free. That's 50% off. You can find that at InfoWarsLife.com. We've extended free shipping for one more week. That was the free shipping we had for the month of July. We've extended that for another week. You can get silver bullet, buy two, get two free, as well as all of the products that we have at InfoWarsLife.com. Silver bullet is our 30 parts per million colloidal silver. Get that with free shipping at 50% off. Stay with us. We're going to be right back after the break. We're going to talk about the next step of Cecil the Lion. It's actually trying to come after the Second Amendment. We'll be right back. I want to go over some individual news accounts, things that are on InfoWars.com. Of course, we have a report. State Department doesn't know legal authority behind Obama's green light to attack Syrian troops. We're going to talk about this in the next hour. We've got some clips, a back and forth video clip between Obama and a reporter trying to nail him down on the authority for this. Of course, they've been trying for a couple of years to start a war against Syria, to get a declaration of war, or just to get justification for the authorization of use of military force, or just to turn public opinion around. And of course, we've seen that in the sarin gas attacks that were exposed to not be from the Syrian forces. And we've seen many different efforts to essentially turn the United States into the Air Force for Al-Qaeda. We've had former congressmen, sitting congressmen, point that out. And of course, now that is exactly what's happening. They've announced that they are going to use jets to strike any pro-rebel, pro-U.S. rebel forces that are under attack by the Syrian government. In other words, they're giving themselves carte blanche to do airstrikes there. At the same time, we've got U.K. forces, the SAS, dressing up as ISIS, and we know that the U.S. has been involved in giving material as well as training to these rebels as a way to take down the Syrian government. They're quietly stepping up this war. They have no authority to do it. This is all just an executive order war. Let's look at some of these other articles that I think show us how the U.S. government cannot ever get enough information about the rest of us. We've got U.S. researchers show that computers can be hijacked to send data as sound waves. This is a team of security researchers have demonstrated the ability to hijack standard equipment inside computers, printers, and millions of other devices in order to send information out of an office via sound waves that may or may not be audible. This is something we don't really realize how much surveillance the government has been capable of, both technologically and by their ignoring our laws against this kind of violation of our privacy. This has been going on, things like this, for a very long time. I remember back in the early 80s when I was working as an engineer, they called it tempesting. And what they would do is they would try to isolate keyboards so that their electronic signals could not be monitored. They had already developed on the U.S. side the ability to eavesdrop inside of a building and listen to the electronic signals that were being sent out by the keyboards if they weren't properly isolated electromagnetically, and then determine what people were typing. That's what's been going on for a very, very long time. Again, some more hacked emails from WikiLeaks showing that Boeing wants to use drones to hack computers from the sky. This is Boeing and the hacking team, that company that's been in the news lately, a Milan, Italy-based company that's criticized for selling surveillance software to repressive governments. Boeing and the hacking team were in talks earlier this year to plant malware on drones to perform such activities, according to emails, which were also stolen from the hacking team in July. Maybe they need a better hacking team. They might want to ally with somebody that's a little bit more sophisticated. But just as we pointed out yesterday, this is not, as the Washington Post puts this out, they start to build a scenario. They always say, oh, this is, let's consider this scenario. A highly desired Al-Qaeda operative is on the lam, so we're going to fly a drone over and listen to them. This is pure BS. As we pointed out yesterday, the vast majority of the espionage that our government is doing is corporate espionage. This is the benefit of U.S. corporations that are highly connected within the U.S. government, getting them information about their European competitors and other people, stealing trade secrets. And then, of course, there's the other aspect that we're all concerned about very much as well, and that is the aspect of population control. But they're going to tell you it's all about getting those Al-Qaeda terrorists. You know, the same people just like ISIS that they equipped and created. Stay with me. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this Wednesday, August 5th, 2015. Some of the stories that are coming up today, of course, we've been talking about Cecil Lyon for the last couple of weeks, as opposed to the mainstream media talking about what's going on with Planned Parenthood, for example, as opposed to the police brutality. And I've said that this is actually not Cecil the Lion, but Cecil the Red Herring, a distraction to take us away from Planned Parenthood. And that's the point of the article from the New American. Feds investigating Cecil the Lion's killer, but Planned Parenthood, of course, is still in the clear. The hunter is now the hunted. Now, this brings up a question as to not only are they trying to distract us from looking at the obvious and horrendous story behind Planned Parenthood, trying to distract us from looking at those who are not doing trophy hunting, but are basically killing children, selling their body parts for a lot of money so they can get their trophy cars, their trophy houses. But it also brings up a lot of other issues of hypocrisy, even beyond that. We've seen airlines say now that they are not going to fly any parts that are any trophy lions. They're not going to allow them on their airlines. Delta is the most recent one to say that's not going to happen. Will they stop flights to Zimbabwe? Will they stop flights because of Mugabe, who has hunted white farmers to extinction in his country, who has impoverished the black people who remain there so that they make about $19 a week per capita? That's the per capita income there. Mugabe, who has killed about 80% of the wildlife there, who for his own birthday ate a baby elephant, as you can see right there, and had a trophy lion presented to him as well. But there's yet another aspect of this, and that is this yet another another way to come after hunting itself and indirectly the Second Amendment? That's where a lot of these people are going, of course, and that was really where red herrings began in the first place, trying to stop fox hunting in the UK by the anti-hunting activists coming out and dragging a stinky fish across the trail so they couldn't do that. And they eventually banned fox hunting there. And regardless of what your feelings are about hunting, you need to understand, as the person who defended getting that trophy lion for Robert Mugabe, you need to understand that these lions who have been, who are older, who are kicked out of the pride, become predators not only of farm animals, but they become predators of humans as well. And so they have hunted them. They could have hunting expeditions in a way that would help to preserve wildlife, but not in a kleptocracy like the one that Robert Mugabe runs in Zimbabwe. But of course, no boycotting of him, simply going after the hunter. Even LionAid says this. They say it'll be difficult to prosecute the person who paid for the hunt because he did what the professional hunters told him to do. They say a client usually has no idea about the laws and regulations of the country that he's hunting in. He just buys a safari, then places himself in the hands of his professional hunter guide. Finding the client would be interesting to let him tell his side of the story, but in terms of legal prosecution, the person is hardly important, they say. And then, of course, there's also the issue that he paid a vast amount of money to this kleptocrat, Robert Mugabe, for the hunt. So he paid permission for the hunt. He had professional hunters. He doesn't know what the laws are there. But we need to be more concerned about that than we are about the people who are killed on the streets, about the babies who are killed in the Planned Parenthood clinics. Another article, severe crackdown in China on church crosses draws a backlash. This is about a dozen, there are churches all over China where they are physically cutting down the crosses. Isn't that interesting? I look at this and I think, how long is it going to be before this type of thing is happening in the United States? Because when people become as ignorant about Christianity as they are about the history of the so-called Civil War, then it will happen. Remember, of course, that the Ku Klux Klan uses the cross as a symbol far more than they do the Confederate flag. As a matter of fact, most of the time they're using the U.S. flag. But here you've got the government cutting down crosses in China. How's that for religious tolerance? Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to be joined at the bottom of the hour with Joe Biggs. He's going to come in and talk about this shooting that's going on in Mississippi, as well as we're going to look at ISIS and what is happening in Syria. Our government is stepping this up to a level of war. This has been going on for quite some time. They've served notice that they're going to be doing airstrikes. They feel justified to do it if pro-U.S. rebels, that would be ISIS, people like Al-Qaeda that McCain has been supporting. Do you understand, of course, when we look at the elections, that we would have gotten this war in Syria with McCain just as we're getting it now with Obama? We would have gotten Obamacare with Romney just as we got it with Obama. I mean, these guys, they always offer us this false choice. It's simply a demographic choice. That's all it really is, because they make sure that they have control of both sides of the argument. We're going to be talking a lot about the Republicans later this week, because that debate is going to be coming up. I want to talk a little bit about Clinton right now, Hillary Clinton. There's a lot of articles that were on the Drudge Report about Hillary Clinton. Let's take a look at some of these headlines. FBI looking into the security of Hillary Clinton's private email setup. So now the FBI is taking a look at it. Don't know if there's going to be any criminal investigation, nevertheless, because we've seen the IRS getting away with this. The IRS can go to Congress and they can lie about how the hard disks were destroyed. They can lie about how they had no backups. And then we can find out that they actually had a parallel texting system that they had put in. Look, these are the people who are consuming the massive intelligence of that is being sucked up about the American people. They are the consumers. They very well know what the surveillance state is about. They're reading all of this stuff. So when they start doing things that are illegal, when they start doing things that they know they can get in trouble with, but maybe with somebody, if somebody ever gets in charge that actually cares what the law is anymore. Nevertheless, they want to try to hide this up. They don't want to have any culpability. So when they know that they're going to do something illegal, these people who know what the surveillance state is, these people who are the consumers of the surveillance state, they set up their parallel systems, whether it's the IRS setting up their parallel texting system or whether it's Hillary Clinton setting up her parallel private email security system. They're doing this deliberately. You know, Carly Fiorina, in the when they went to this Saturday to talk to the Koch brothers, it was a private meeting, but we heard some of the comments were leaked out, and she had one of the best jokes at that. She said Clinton was so technologically backward that she had chosen a couple of Secret Service agents to guard her servers. No, she's not ignorant. She's just criminal. She's criminal. She knows because she's a consumer of this dragnet surveillance. She's one of these people. She knows exactly what's going on with this. And of course, it's not just questions about that server, but it's also questions about her close aide, Huma Abedin, who was not only involved now with these emails, but we also see there's other questions surfacing about Huma. She was paid, given a $33,000 payout from the State Department for unused leave. She's using her simultaneous employment inside and outside of the government to deliver favors to Clinton cronies, say some people who are alleging that she's been doing this since 2008. They say that Ms. Abedin and Ms. Mills used private email accounts for official business, just like their boss, whose secretive email set up with private accounts hosted on a server in Mrs. Clinton's home in New York has raised questions about her skirting. Open the pantsuit lady is skirting open record laws and mishandling classified information. They say Huma planned a party for Clinton pals on the taxpayer dime. This is New York Post. They say that, and here's some of the emails that they found. She says, I have the packet with the floor, the Pantone color options, and the floor plan. My bigger problem right now is I can't even get into my Clinton email, and I wanted to print all the latest documents to go through line by line with Oscar. Whatever. De La Renta designed both Abedin and Chelsea Clinton's wedding dresses. These are the elitist crony capitalists that run our government, the criminals, okay? This would be called corruption in any other time, in any other country. Now it's called standard operating procedure. They say an internal State Department probe recently found that Abedin got paid with taxpayer funds for days that she was working with the Clinton Foundation. And while she was vacationing in Europe with her hubby, Anthony the Wiener, the State Department has asked her to repay the money, but she is contesting the findings. Senate Judiciary Chairman Chuck Grassley wrote the State Department demanding more information about her quote-unquote special government employee status. That says that she is somebody with very unique skills that can hold three jobs from the government simultaneously and also get paid off in the private sector as well. Now, Hillary Clinton is seeing all this stuff. And of course, how does she portray herself as one of the people? You know, she talked about how after coming out of the White House, she and Bill were just so incredibly poor. You know, these people who had nothing and became multimillionaires off the political process. They were just, you know, abjectly poor. Nobody was buying it. Nobody is buying all of this stuff. As I've mentioned before, The Onion is running articles making fun of her arrogance, talking about how the FEC has put her on 3 weeks probation where she's not allowed to campaign because they caught her spitting on campaign volunteers. So here's what she's doing now. She's trying to portray, as we pointed out yesterday, we showed the video that she's running, showing her mother, because Hillary Clinton now wants to reinvent herself to change her image, because this is all about identity politics, folks. You're not going to get any difference between the policies of Hillary Clinton and the policies of Jeb Bush. They're going to own both sides of that, just like they did McCain and Obama and Obama and Romney. So now she's reinventing herself as a grandmother. I want to play a clip for you where she's not only going to be a grandmother, but a Southern granny. Let's play that Southern granny clip.
Hillary Clinton, welcome to Chair Chats.
Jamie, I'm delighted to be here. I love sitting here and rocking. So thanks for giving me the chance to do that.
Yeah, you know, maybe what she's going to do next. I think this is what she's trying to portray herself as a granny in her commercials. She's going with a Southern accent. So maybe what we'll do is see her with her entourage running around instead of hiding out in a darked out van. Maybe what they'll do is put her on the back of a pickup truck, like Granny from the Beverly Hillbillies, and put her in a rocking chair, you know, just like she was right there. She can tell everybody how she likes to cook vittles. You know, the Beverly Hillbillies was a fish out of water comedy where you took somebody that was not sophisticated and you put them in a very sophisticated area. She is now doing just the opposite. She's trying to pretend somebody who is very sophisticated, very calculating, is trying to pretend that she's not. She's somebody who is a ruthless shark, and she's trying to pretend that she's an innocent little granny from the Beverly Hillbillies. It's not working. Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders are now in a dead heat in New Hampshire. They say that Bernie Sanders is polling 42, oh, she's polling 42%, and Bernie Sanders is polling 36% in the latest horse race poll coming out of New Hampshire. That's pretty amazing, isn't it? When you can have a felonious elitist like Hillary Clinton still beating Bernie Sanders. That doesn't look good for the Democrats. But of course, on the Republican side, there's a lot of problems as well. The stock market is not doing well. The bad news on Apple stock is only the beginning, they say. And of course, I think this has a lot to do with the CEO of Apple, Tim Cook, being more interested in being an activist for gay rights than he is in terms of doing any kind of product development. We saw how this happened before for Apple, although now it's going to have a lot of massive consequences for the entire stock market because they're now part of the Dow Jones Industrial Market. I remember back when he was run out of the company by John Sculley, who worked for Pepsi. They wanted somebody in who was going to be a marketing type. He wasn't a product guy. He wasn't a visionary. And when they ran him out, it didn't take very long for Apple to get on the ropes. So I remember just before Steve Jobs came back, all the writing in the technical journals and places like Wired Magazine, they were saying, well, I think Apple ought to just sell off their hardware business and they need to reinvent themselves just as an operating system company like Microsoft, and they would make more money. But Steve Jobs came back. He came back as an interim CEO. He had the title iCEO, and then he made the iPod, the iMac, and all these other products. He was a genius in terms of editing things. He never really created anything, but he really knew how to get things going. I think when you look at history, there's a lot of different approaches to looking at history. There's a cyclical approach. I think that's a very valid approach. We've talked about how the book by Ernst and, Strauss and Howe, about the fourth turning, that goes back and looks at the cyclical nature of history. I think that's very true. I think, though, there's also, it's very important who the individuals are. I think we can see this in the rise and fall of companies. We can see that very, very clearly. Now, of course, later this week, we have the big debate that is coming up, and we'll be covering that in depth here at InfoWars, both on the radio show and in the nightly news. Here's an analysis of who has made the final cut, because they have now talked about the 10 candidates that are going to be in that cut, and they go down on a point-by-point basis from USA Today. Susan Page says, here's what they need to do, according to her. Donald Trump, let the Donald be Donald. Well, yeah, he's not afraid to speak truth to power. That's why he's become so popular, and I think he's got a lot of the right policies. My questions with Donald Trump really boil down to his ethics. Can we trust him to do what he says? You know, we just trusted the Republicans to do what they would say less than a year ago. What is it, about 10 months ago, 9 months ago that we reelected them, and they did nothing that they said they were going to do. So can we trust Donald Trump to do it? That's my issue with him. I think he needs to establish the fact that he is trustworthy and not just in this for himself. Jeb Bush, they say, be his own man. Essentially what they're saying about Donald Trump, too. Donald, be the Donald. Jeb Bush, be his own man. As opposed to the man of who? The CIA? Goldman Sachs? Scott Walker? Competent? Well, okay, he's trying to... Mike Huckabee, remember me, they say? Well, he's going to have to do something other than just come up with glib comments and approach from 20 years ago. When they talk about Rand Paul, they say, well, he has an alternative view of the world. Yeah, a strange alternative view of the world where individual rights in the Constitution matter. That's why we're going to watch this debate. Joining us in the next segment is going to be Joe Biggs, and we're going to talk about this shooting that has happened now for 2 days outside a military base in Mississippi, Camp Shelby. We're also going to talk about what's going on in Syria, because that is stepping up, and we have a back and forth that we're going to play for you between the State Department and a reporter asking for the legal authority to attack Syrian troops because they are step by step stepping this up into a full-blown war, making no bones about it, saying they're going to use airstrikes and so forth, and are doing that now. So we're going to talk to Joe Biggs about that when we come back. I want to get back to politics just a little bit, too, give you a preview of what's coming up later this week. Before I do, I want to let you know about the flash sale that we have at InfoWarsLife.com. We have a 24-hour sale, 30% off, DNA Force. This is one of our most serious hardcore products that we have at InfoWars Life. It's loaded with a very expensive, very powerful compound, BioPQQ, that's backed by 175 clinical studies. BioPQQ even contains more potent antioxidant activity than vitamin C. Give your body the force field that it needs. Get DNA Force right now, 30% off at InfoWarsLife.com while supplies last. And also, we have free shipping, not only for DNA Force that's on sale, but also for everything that is at InfoWarsLife.com. We've extended that for one more week. And I'll just remind you as well that we have a Silver Bullet, buy two, get two for free. So it's a good time to stock on that, stock up on that as well. Everything at the store right now, free shipping for this week. Now, going back to what we were just talking about when we ran out of time at the break, the USA Today is analyzing these 10 candidates that are going to be on the debate on Thursday. And, of course, we've got Donald Trump as the one at top. They say, let Donald be Donald. Jeb Bush, be his own man. In other words, the kind of the same advice on all these guys. Scott Walker will be there, Mike Huckabee. And I got to say, you know, the glib comments that I see from Huckabee when we're facing the kind of severe problems that we are in this country, it just doesn't resonate with me. It's just a cognitive dissonance to see that. And the fact that he would defend innocent life is good, but at the same time, he is such an incredible warmonger along with Lindsey Graham. And that dissonance there, I find that very disturbing, very, very bothering to see somebody, a former pastor, promoting war to the extent that Mike Huckabee does. Ben Carson. They say he needs to show people that he's not just a doctor. Yeah, he needs to show people that he really has read the Constitution. I haven't seen much evidence of that, that he understands the Constitution, that he understands the principles involved. This is somebody who, when it came to the Second Amendment, has previously said that he thought that it was fine for people who live out in the country, but people in the city don't need to have guns. That's pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. You don't understand the principles. You don't understand the law. Okay, so you need to take a look at that. He's also somebody who has pushed for mandatory vaccines. He's a doctor, and he thinks he understands what vaccines are about, but he certainly doesn't know the first thing about our rights and our informed consent, nor does he respect that. Ted Cruz, they say Trump, but with electoral experience. Yeah, he likes to get out there and say controversial things, speak his mind. He has electoral experience, but he is not eligible to run for president. If you look at the natural born citizen requirements, Marco Rubio needs to get back in the game. He's just run in for vice president. That's all I think about Marco Rubio. And again, he is down the line, your typical middle of the road GOP warmongering statist authoritarian. Rand Paul, they say an alternative view of the world. And as I said, it would be nice to hear an alternative to the kinds of policies that Marco Rubio and most of the GOP advocate. And that's precisely what we heard a little bit of on Monday night. We played some excerpts from that very boring forum in New Hampshire where they asked Rand Paul about dragnet surveillance and then they asked Marco Rubio about it. Of course, Marco Rubio gave us the tired old excuses we always hear from the GOP. It's all about national security. And we've seen so many, I can tell you being on the inside, he says, I've seen so many attacks that we have shut down. Baloney. Baloney. NSA whistleblowers have told us that's baloney. They told us they had the intel. They could have stopped what was going on with 9/11. They chose not to. They don't do that. They only make their haystack to find their needle. They only make it bigger with all of these issues. And of course, we know about how the FBI manufactures so many of these threats that they go public with. Chris Christie, they say, you want somebody that's combative? Get Chris Christie. Well, you know, I don't know. I, for one, I think a lot of people have had enough of belligerence just for the sake of belligerence. It was this weekend, and we talk about how this is a horse race. It was just this weekend that Chris Christie, they say, this is Business Insider, got mercilessly booed at a horse race in New Jersey. Interestingly enough, it was at that same track, Monmouth track, that we were playing those clips of the horse race from earlier. And I think it's very fitting. He came out very belligerently against states' rights, saying that if he becomes president, he's going to stop the decriminalization of marijuana that's gone on in places. I tell you what, this is the question that I would ask any of these guys. If I was a guy, can the government ban anything? That's an article up on Infowars.com. You need to read that because I don't have the authority. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Joe Biggs. Joining me now is Joe Biggs. And Joe is here to give us an update on what's going on in Mississippi. Of course, shots were fired yesterday and again today at Camp Shelby. Joe, what's the update on this?
Well, the thing we got to think about is this a paranoid person who actually has been watching all these YouTube videos saying that Jade Helm was going to essentially just come after everyone individually and take them and put them in FEMA camps? Or is this just a random act? I mean, because this is 2 days now, a red truck, they haven't got anybody. And then now, just about an hour ago, they've detained a guy who was in a red truck. He said he didn't have any guns and his truck was backfiring. So now you have these cops just pulling over everyone in a red truck in Hattiesburg, right outside of Camp Shelby.
You got a red truck, you're a suspect.
Yeah, if you got a red truck, you're a suspect.
Kind of like if you got a white van, you're a suspect and there's a gazillion white vans.
Yeah, it's like when you're in Iraq, everything is a Toyota Corolla.
Yeah.
Every car is, so you have to be on a watch for a Toyota Corolla, and that's the only car they have.
Well, of course, the other aspect of this, too, that a lot of people are concerned about is this going to be, we always have to be concerned that there's a false flag, but it's still a risk to the people who are there. You know, whether it's a false flag or somebody that's paranoid about it or somebody that is, you know, we were told they're saying that it's a white man in a red pickup truck. But we were told that about the shootings at the recruiting stations as well. He was identified as a white man. It turned out that he was an Islamic jihadi.
Well, they have
even
no problem.
They deny that.
They have no problem identifying a white man.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But, you know, they'll never want to call it what it is. Like, we can't ever say extremism. We can't ever say, you know, Islamic extremism, but if it's a white guy, we can go ahead and throw that on the table. That's easy. We can throw that out right away,
even when it's not true.
Exactly.
And then when it is true, this guy, Muhammad, was an Islamic jihadi who hated these guys. And clearly this wasn't that he just pulled up and decided that he would go on a mass shooting spree, and it just happened to be at a recruiting station. He shot up the one recruiting station, goes to another location and shoots that up, another recruiting. So he's obviously targeting the military. He's obviously talked online about being a jihadi, but they can't go there. They won't talk about that.
Yeah, it's not extreme. Apparently that's just workplace violence again.
We have another story that we haven't talked about yet, really. CBS Denver is reporting that the FBI says there's Middle Eastern men intimidating U.S. military families in Colorado and Wyoming. They say an alert has been issued by the FBI to all law enforcement agencies in Colorado and Wyoming involving U.S. military families' concerns about who may be watching them. They say in this particular case last May, for example, and there's been some additional ones recently, the wife of a military member was approached in front of her home by two Middle Eastern males. The men stated that she was a wife of a U.S. interrogator. So I said, your husband's a U.S. interrogator. They confront her about that. When she denied their claims, they laughed at her, then left the area in a sedan with two other Middle Eastern males in the vehicle. They say that that vehicle had been seen in the neighborhood on previous occasions as well. Similar incidents in Wyoming have been reported to the FBI throughout June 2015. And then there is this notice that they have embedded in the report at CBS that is dated 2nd July 2015. Middle Eastern males approaching family members of U.S. military personnel at their homes in Colorado and Wyoming as of June 2015.
Well, so this is real then.
Yeah.
Because if the FBI had a hand in this, they would have already busted it because they would have set the people up. And then we've already had arrests by now. Mm-hmm. So this makes me think this is an actual legitimate threat. There's something going on, because when it's real, the FBI is nowhere to be seen. They can't do their job.
That's right.
It's an actual legitimate threat. These people, they've seen the same vehicle and the same people in their area numerous times, and yet the FBI can't get them.
Mm-hmm. That's been going on for over a year, and they're not doing anything about it. And this is small town USA.
Yeah, I doubt there's a lot of Arabic people driving around in the same vehicle.
Yeah, exactly. Now, and this is interesting, I think, too, because we look at the fact that just recently we've had these massive hacks of federal employee databases, even getting, I think it was 4.5 million fingerprints. I mean, if you can get somebody's fingerprints, you can certainly find out what their jobs are within the military. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's easy when the government collects everything on people. It makes everybody vulnerable, even the people who work for the government. Joe, I remember years and years ago, when they first started doing these automated toll technology, first started presenting itself, I remember there was a debate in the Netherlands over whether they would allow this or not. People were concerned about their privacy, and they were so concerned about it because their government there, you know, being a good you know, a Dutch government where everything is very efficient and everything. They were keeping all this information about the citizens on 3x5 cards. They had them packed so tightly that when the Germans came in with a blitzkrieg, very rapidly overtook their country, they tried to destroy these records, but they were packed so tightly they couldn't set them on fire. And so the Nazis got all this information and just used it as a shopping list to get anybody that they thought might be a problem for them. Anybody that was Jewish, anybody that would oppose them as a political opponent or whatever, just use it as a shopping list to go round people up and take them to concentration camps. And that's precisely what our government has created, even for its own employees here.
Well, I mean, also, too, you have operational security, OPSEC. There's a lot of people who post information on Facebook that they just shouldn't be posting as well, too. Mm-hmm. And they don't understand that when you look at someone's profile and you accept that friend, just because you see a picture of someone who looks friendly, that doesn't mean that's who it is. And there's a lot of these guys who troll these accounts, and they know based on being overseas, someone will get their name and go, all right, start looking for this guy's Facebook account. And sure enough, you'll have guys saying, oh, I'm an interrogator for the U.S. Army. I'm this and that. Oh, this is where I live. They don't make anything private. Most people don't think it'll ever happen to them. And that's one way you can get a lot of this information too, and it can come back and bite you in the butt.
Well, of course, we see that with people who aren't in the military, right? They're talking, and they may be talking about stuff that is perfectly innocent. They may be talking about politics, and they may get identified by the government as being somebody who is a threat to them. That's what we're seeing in this latest Planned Parenthood situation, where you got a CNN anchor using the term of art that the government had just created. They're creating a new department under FEMA, under Homeland Security, that is going to look at violent extremists. They're going to identify them as, before they do anything, just as Wesley Clark floated the trial balloon. Congressman McCall was putting in the legislation, and of course it just passed through committee, breezed through there unanimously on its way to becoming a law, where they're going to come after people just because they identify, based on their computer models, whether or not they think you're going to be some kind of a threat to them. And as Wesley Clark said, you know, you can exercise your free speech, that's fine, but we put people in prison camps that we thought were threats to us.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to put you in a prison camp if we think that you might become an extremist, if you might become violent. And some of the things that he mentioned off of social media were, well, let's say that you your girlfriend broke up with you, you lost your job or whatever. They're looking at all of that stuff.
Yeah, they're saying that you're depressed, you're drunk posting stuff, and then they go back and look at your pictures. You got pictures with guns everywhere,
yeah,
and you're sitting there doing all these, you know, little poses. Yeah. And they're like, oh my God, this guy, he's about to snap.
Yeah.
His girlfriend broke up with him. He owns guns. He's obviously going to go on a violent rampage.
Yeah.
Let's go get this guy.
You post a lot of pictures of yourself holding guns on the internet, you're liable to even have them use you as a patsy and then put those pictures up to justify the fact, look at this guy, was crazy.
Or have the VA contact you and go, you know what, yeah, sir? We're going to have to take your benefits away. We're no longer going to be able to give you any more patient care. We've deemed you, you know, crazy. So we're going to have to come and take your guns.
Or Social Security, although, yeah, I don't think, to me, people on Social Security are really, well, maybe they are using social media. I guess a lot of them are using Facebook.
A little bit,
yeah,
more and more.
Yeah. Well, look at this also, because when we're talking about these guys, Middle East individuals are contacting U.S. military and making threats to them. This article comes out, Arabic is now the most common language of refugees in America. There's a mess. Not only are we working with ISIS and Al-Qaeda, creating these organizations, equipping them, training them. And we've had numerous times we've talked about that. There's been a video caught of them delivering weapons, massive quantities by helicopter, or they pull out of an area and just let these guys take it over. But now we're stepping it up to where our government has said, we're going to launch airstrikes against anybody that we think are pro-U.S. rebels.
That's something Obama's been going after for a long time. He is hell-bent on going after Syria.
Mm-hmm.
They, oh, yeah, want to, and it's funny because they keep doing this under, you know, the beard of the Cecil the Lion, the new plane wreckage stuff that's washed up on the island.
Yeah.
You know, but meanwhile, while they're talking about this and everyone in the country is in tears and up in arms over this lion in Africa, Obama is trying to put us full on in war with Syria.
Absolutely. And of course, this is, again, going back to Wesley Clark, the same guy who was just floating the trial balloon about detaining people, putting them in prison camps like we did Japanese people just because they were Japanese during World War II, saying that we're going to identify people and put them away. It was Wesley Clark who said that Syria was on the list. He said it was next on the list a long time ago. He had a list of several countries that we were going to go to war with. But when we look at this article about Arabic, they're pointing out that of the 11,300 refugees that have been admitted to the U.S. this year, 4,400 of them speak Arabic. In other words, that's more than a third of the people coming in. So not only are these people our allies, not only are we equipping people who are rebels that are pro-U.S., so to speak, okay, but just like we created Al-Qaeda, we called them the Mujahideen when we created them against the Russians. And then Osama bin Laden became our most wanted man or whatever. They're bringing these people who they think that they control into the United States now, massive quantity.
Yeah, they bring them in, and then they also can come across the porous border on the south side.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh, yeah.
And we've seen it time
and
time
again. Well, these are legal. These are guys that they brought in legally, gave sanction to, made them refugees and everything. And, of course, as you point out, we don't know how many are coming in across the border.
And we don't know how many are being legally brought in who are sleeper cells as well, people who are waiting to be brought over, patiently sitting there waiting. It's happened before.
Mm-hmm.
Waiting to be activated, just waiting on that one thing that they're told to, and then they go and attack. And then, like we showed, the drug smuggling come across the border. It's not just about drugs. Yeah, we know drugs come across the border every day. Mm-hmm. Got it. Mm-hmm. But one time, one of those packages could be a dirty bomb.
Mm-hmm.
It's not always just drugs. We know drugs are coming across, but just as easy as I saw those seven guys come across the river with those packages, that could be a dirty bomb, that could be ISIS, that could be anything, because we have no eyes on it. We're not watching. And it's easy for these Border Patrol guys to get paid off to look the other way.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that was part of what you saw when you were there.
Yeah.
And, of course, they come in within the, well into the United States border and start harassing American citizens, demanding to know
all the way up
to see
in,
our identity papers, just like we're Nazi Germany or something. Yeah. Let's take a look at this this video. This is the State Department fielding questions from a pretty persistent reporter asking, what is the legal authority for us to start a war with Syria or to step up the war that's been going on for some time there? Here's that clip.
What is the legal basis for the authority that the Obama administration gave itself to attack anyone who's attacking Syrian opposition forces that the U.S. trains?
The legal authority?
Yes, legal basis.
You're talking about in Syria and in protection of ISIL, anti-ISIL coalition fighters that have in part been trained by the U.S.
Yes.
I frankly don't know what the legal authority is. What we're very clear about is that, they're fighting in, frankly, a lawless area of Syria. They're under attack and under pressure from a lot of different forces, mostly ISIL, ISIL, but other forces as well in that region. We talked about this yesterday, is the fact that, we're bringing airstrikes to bear on ISIL in that area as they advance on ISIL-held territory or ISIL-held territory and supporting them in that way. And that's actually been effective in fighting ISIL. It's a very complex and fluid situation. I get that. What we were trying to convey is that we'll also do defensive efforts in case or in the hypothetical that they would come under fire from Syrian forces.
So the only thing that changed since the announcement is the authority to go after Assad government forces, basically, because the U.S. had been bombing ISIS targets.
It's not the authority to go after. Just let me clarify. I said defensive measures.
I'm sorry. But what would be the legal basis for attacking Syrian government forces? Is that the AUMF? Do you have congressional authorization for that?
As part of the coalition, and obviously, but we've been carrying out airstrikes in that region for many months now, almost a year. And the same in defense of these groups, but also to help them gain territory back from ISIL. These are any type of effort to protect them from Syrian forces would be defensive in nature. But I'm not going to talk about the legal framework.
But this is a major shift in policy. It's one thing to go after ISIS. It's something else to attack forces that threaten the forces that go after ISIS. Do you have congressional approval for that? Are you going to seek congressional approval for that? Under what authorization are you doing that?
Steps we took would be in close consultation with Congress.
Oh, I'm sorry, but why do you think you don't need a UN Security Council decision on this?
Was that why don't we think we need one?
You don't need
one. We're obviously
one.
In close because consultations with the UN Security Council. Syria is a very complex situation. I've said this multiple times.
Let's stop it right there because I want to talk about this. You know, when I hear them talking about this as if they need to get UN Security Council clearance, I'm reminded, Joe, of that back and forth between Senator Sessions and Leon Panetta when he was defense secretary. And Sessions is saying, you know, under what conditions can you use military force? And he goes, and he's trying to get him to say, well, we would go to Congress and we would get a declaration from Congress, because constitutionally that's what's required. But of course, Panetta didn't say that. He would say, well, we will talk to the people at NATO, we'll talk to the United Nations. And Senator Sessions says, well, what about Congress? Well, we would advise Congress as to what we're doing. And he's like, I can't believe what I'm hearing here. You were a former congressman. You know what the Constitution says. You know that you're supposed to get authorization for war from Congress, not from NATO, not from the UN. And of course, now they really could care less even about going to those two. They're going to do whatever they wish at this point.
Syria is going to get demolished and ISIS will come out on top, because there's been air campaigns going on over Syria, supposedly going after ISIS for almost a year now from multiple mm-hmm. different countries. And there's been reports that there has been zero effect on ISIS, on their manpower whatsoever. So with all these air campaigns going on to go after ISIS, they've really had no significant drop in manpower on the ground out there. And the only people who are suffering are the people of Syria.
Well, exactly as this reporter said, it's a different thing to attack ISIS and to defend ISIS. And that's what they're talking about with this policy, is defending ISIS. And of course, they created ISIS. They created ISIS as a tool to overthrow Syria. Mm-hmm. And they've been trying to go after Syria. Now ISIS is spilling over into Iraq and so forth and so on. Whether they wish that to happen or whether that's an unintended consequence, we don't really know. But it's amazing for me to see this guy talking about how, well, I don't know what legal authority. He doesn't even address that. He says, well, it's a lawless area. It's kind of like when Al Gore said, there's no controlling legal authority here in the White House. And that's true. There is no controlling legal authority in Washington, because Washington itself is a lawless area. But he says, these are defensive measures. I mean, we're there. We've created this rebel force, ISIS, that's there. What are we defending? We're defending ISIS. These are defensive measures for ISIS.
We're gonna attack the guys who are going after ISIS like we're supposed to be doing.
Yes.
I mean, it's crazy that it's in front of the American people and people are so blind to it. And all they care about is a damn line.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We're going to be right back with Joe Biggs. In the next hour, we're going to be talking to Lionel. And of course, the question about pre-crime is one of the things we'll be bringing up with Lionel. Stay with us. We're going to talk about ISIS and what is happening with ISIS in the United States. It's not just in Syria. We'll be right back. Joining me in studio is Joe Biggs. We're going to go back to what we were just talking about, and that is there any controlling legal authority in Washington? Does anybody care other than one reporter from RT who we just played that back and forth in the State Department? Before we go back to the discussion, real quickly, I want to let you know that in addition to free shipping this week, we also have a couple of big specials. One of them is a flash sale. That's a 24-hour sale on DNA Force. 30% off DNA Force for 24 hours. It's our most hardcore product yet from InfoWars Life, loaded with BioPQQ compound that's backed by 175 clinical studies. BioPQQ even contains more potent antioxidant activity than vitamin C. And you can get that with a huge savings right now. 30% off of DNA Force for the next 24 hours, as well as free shipping on everything in the store, including things like Silver Bullet, where we have a buy two, get two free. That's 50% off of Silver Bullet. If you buy that in a quantity of two, you get two for free. Again, everything at the store, InfoWarsLife.com, is free shipping this week as a thank you to those who support our operation here. Now, Joe, as we were just talking about this amazing back and forth between this RT reporter who would not take no for an answer, she apparently knows more and cares more about the Constitution than anybody in our government, certainly yeah. in the Obama administration. But, you know, Joe, when we look at what's going to be coming up with this debate later this week, candidates like your favorite, Lindsey Graham.
Yeah. God almighty.
They're going to be pushing for even more of this kind of criminal activity. Just, you know, go to war with Syria, go to war everywhere that you want to go. They think that Obama's not doing enough of this.
Him and John McCain are just a trip. I'm telling you, these guys are hell-bent on just complete and total global war.
Yeah.
Bloodthirsty. I mean, I've never, you know, growing up, in between South Carolina and Florida. My mom was from South Carolina, actually right outside of Belmont, where this the three preppers were arrested by FBI, you know, for supposedly wanting to go ballistic about Jade Helm. And my grandparents were big contributors, you know, they paid into a lot of these different campaigns. And when I was young, my grandparents liked Lindsey Graham, and I never understood it.
I was like, what is going on?
I mean, even as a child, I was like, this guy is demented.
Yeah, he is.
And now that I've gotten older, he is just the worst human being.
Well, I mean, the good news is that he's now been relegated to the junior varsity debate, along with Rick Perry, Rick Santorum, Lindsey Graham. Those guys are going to be in a junior varsity debate because their poll figures are so incredibly low. The bad news is I've got to watch that JV debate. I've got to watch like 6 to 8 hours of Fox News, and you're going to have to put me on a suicide watch.
Oh, Thursday, I'm going to be watching. I actually have a large group of friends here in the Austin area.
Yeah.
We're going to get together, grill some steaks, have a few beers, and just watch this and have, I don't know. I'm kind of interested to see how Donald Trump's going to come out because he's a character. He's a funny guy. To see if anyone attacks him and to see how he comes back.
It'll be real interesting. And, you know, he's had, and I don't know if it's his policies or if it's ghostwriters who've written the books for him. But, you know, when he's talked in the past about immigration, he's done so, in the book at least, he actually had some good points in terms of removing some of the incentives that are behind the subsidies that are behind the massive open borders. Of course, he's not going to talk about how this is an engineered global crisis. They're not going to get to that. But it's going to be an interesting debate.
Building a giant wall is not going to help either, because if you build a wall, you can dig a hole under it.
That's right. But the giant wall will help to keep us in.
Yeah, exactly.
It'll help us so they can
look for identity papers.
Exactly. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Stay with me for the next segment, Joe. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining me now is Joe Biggs. I'm going to keep Joe here for one more segment, and then we're going to be joined by Lionel. And I've got some questions to ask Lionel. I want to get his opinion about what's happening with politics. But I think there's also, we've got an article up on Infowars.com. And this is the question, Joe, that I would ask any of these candidates if I was allowed to ask one of them. I would say, can the federal government ban anything? I mean, we had a constitutional amendment to ban alcohol. We got another one. We had the 18th, what was it, 18 and 21st, I think, to ban it and then to make it legal again. We had 100 years ago a Congress that recognized that they did not have the authority. The federal government was not delegated the authority, and the 9th and 10th Amendments make it very clear that unless they're expressly given the authority, they don't have it. That's still retained by the people, by the states. The states could create alcohol prohibition if they wanted to, or they could, like we've seen with Colorado and with Washington State, they could say we're going to decriminalize marijuana. But we've got a Republican candidate, Chris Christie, who says that if he's elected president, he's going to shut that down. So the question I would ask these guys is, where's your authority to ban anything, including things like cancer drug treatments or supplements like many of them have tried to ban?
I just don't get why people would jump on this whole ban marijuana wagon, because you have to understand how many people out there who smoke pot, who normally aren't going to go out and vote. As soon as you do that, I mean, it seemed like that would be a smart move to make, to go ahead and be all in for it, legalize it. You're going to get a lot of people's votes.
Yeah, yeah.
And at the end of the day, guess what? It's not a bad thing. It helps people out.
Yeah, I don't think it really helped Chris Christie do that, because as I pointed out before, when he went to the New Jersey racetrack on Sunday, he was routinely booed. Of course, he's not very popular now in New Jersey. I don't think he'd get reelected as governor, so maybe he'll fail up. But I don't think so. I think he's in that junior varsity team now, as far as the debate goes. I don't know. He might have made the top 10, but I'm not sure. I'd have to go back and look at that again. Oh, he did make the top 10. Okay. So he's in the top 10. But, of course, this is something that, again, is really simply a horse race, like the story I mentioned yesterday. Just 2 months ago, if we look at the totals that people had, we had Bush, Carson, Huckabee, Rubio, Walker, all tied at 10%, according to a Quinnipiac poll that was just 2 months ago. And then there was Rand Paul at 7%, but of course he didn't show up. They excised that. They took him out, and they showed people who got less than Rand Paul, which would be Cruz at 5%, Trump at 5%, Christie at 4%, Fiorina at 2%, Kasich at 2%, but Rand Paul at 7%, he didn't show up. And then we have now, over the last couple of months, because of the inflammatory rhetoric that Donald Trump has said, also because he speaks truth to power. That's very attractive to people, but he's also said it in a very inflammatory way. He's gotten a lot of coverage. He's gotten, as Rand Paul points out, probably about $1 billion worth of coverage. If you look at the number of minutes that they have given to people, he's gotten virtually all of the coverage.
Trump's going to lead it the whole way, and then when it comes time, Bush is going to be the guy that comes in.
Yeah, it's interesting.
But that should open people's eyes, though, to show you that the American people are obviously voting out there and, you know, going out doing these polls, and people like Trump, they like what he says, but the establishment doesn't want that. They want someone that they can buy out. They've already bought out that entire family.
Yes.
And they want to get him in.
Yes, very true. And it's interesting also, you know, to look at Donald Trump. I mean, he was originally, you know, when we talk about him, is he a dark horse candidate? Is he a stalking horse? Is he there as cover for somebody like a Jeb Bush or even Hillary Clinton? Because before he started giving money to Republicans, he was giving a lot of money to the Clinton family. He also gave money to Ted Cruz. About a year ago, he was saying that he didn't think that Ted Cruz was qualified to run for president because of the natural born citizen requirements. Then he changed his tune. He started giving money to Ted Cruz before he himself started running for presidency. And of course, the two of them have met privately. They have a very similar stance in terms of saying things that are going to be offensive to the Washington power structure. That's a lot of the popularity of both of them. So it'll be interesting to see how this works out. Thank you so much for joining us. Joe Biggs, stay with us right after the break. We're going to be talking to Lionel. We'll be right back. Joining us in this segment is Lionel, and we're going to get to Lionel in just a moment. Before we do, I want to let you know about the sales that we have at InfoWarsLife.com. We have a 24-hour flash sale on DNA Force. 30% off for the next 24 hours. We also have a buy two silver bullet, get two free. That's through this week, and we have free shipping through this week on everything at the store. Things like Nascent Iodine, Survival Shield X2. Anything that you get at the InfoWars Life store is free shipping this week. We extended it one more week as a thank you to those who support our operation here. That's InfoWarsLife.com. Now, going back to Lionel, Lionel is an Emmy Award-winning television news decoder. And so we're going to talk to him and have him decode some of the news, especially about Donald Trump. Interesting comments he's had about Donald Trump, as well as a legal analyst. So we're going to ask him some questions about the family as well. He's a licensed trial lawyer and a former prosecutor as well. LionelMedia.com, and you can find him on Twitter at Lionel Media. At Lionel Media, that's his Twitter handle. Thanks for joining us, Lionel.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I've got a couple of articles. Let's start out with what's happening to our children. What's happening with this out-of-control state? Here's a couple of headlines I'll just throw at you. One of them, both of these I was going to talk about yesterday, but I didn't have time. A couple of articles that were up on InfoWars.com. One of them, a video shows a cop handcuffing elementary school-aged disabled child, bullying this disabled child who is in a wheelchair, handcuffing this kid. Another one from the UN says, jail parents who spank their children. It looks like they want to be our mommies and daddies. They're spanking us using the police. And essentially, our schools have turned into training camps for living in a prison society, haven't they, Lionel?
Well, you know, the prison industrial complex is now merging into the farm team for indoctrination and retraining. Couple of things. First, I absolutely, positively am against the notion of spanking. Hitting anybody for any reason to train, to discipline at all. Now, that being said, parents, and especially teachers, but when a parent exercises a parental control and believes in good faith that this is in the best interest of the child, and there's no welts or trauma, the police should not be involved in that. Here's what's going on. I want you to imagine, and many of the people listening and watching today, who have a child who has special needs, emotionally handicapped, emotionally disturbed, behavioral, and I don't even want to use these terms because I'm not sure what terms people find objectionable, but I think you know what we're talking about. Now, David, I have been a prosecutor. I've been a lawyer most of my adult life. I have seen grown men, tough, cry like a baby when they're put in the back of a patrol car, when they feel the wrist bracelets of being handcuffed and the fear, the lights, the sound. It's a It's a sensory overload. The whole spectrum of this. These are grown men. Now imagine, David, you're a child who doesn't necessarily understand things the way we wish that child would. And through the prism of a child, sees this horror and wonders, I'm not in trouble. This isn't a note to my parent. I'm being arrested. I'm in the back of a patrol car. I'm being frog marched out of my class, subject to the humiliation, the shame, the ignominy, the finger pointing. I'm put into the back of a patrol car. I'm going to come back to school and hear the chiding and the remarks. Hey, jailbird. For, this is the best part, on my column today, on my piece today at lionelmedia.com, I reprinted an article, David, showing 19 examples of why kids are being arrested. Burping and belching in class. Failing to pick, I'm serious, yeah. Failing to pick up crumbs. Writing on a desk, scribbling, I love Abby, and being arrested for showing love. Now, I can go on and on. Now, if you think that this is somehow getting tough, you know, spare the rod, spoil the child, if you think that and you don't see what's happening in the militarization of the police now bleeding over into the classroom.
Yeah, that's the thing that's really concerning, because you and I went to school, we didn't have police in the schools. We had spanking in the schools, quite frankly. And one of the reasons I brought that up was because I thought it was such an amazing counterpoint to each other. At the same time, the UN, which is not involved in America, shouldn't be involved in America, wants to dictate to parents how to do discipline. We turn the police state loose on our children in our schools to not only do things that are far worse than the spankings that we used to have from the principals. They are tasering children. We have a kid down here in Bastrop that got tasered. He wasn't doing anything. You can see the video footage. The cop walks up to him. It was a fight. He wasn't even involved in the fight. He was, if anything, he was trying to stop the people. Nothing was going on. Hits him with a taser. The kid falls down, hits his head on a concrete floor, and now he's brain damaged for the rest of his life. What's going on when they come after parents and saying, we're going to take your kids away. If you spank kids, we're going to throw you in jail. And yet they send out these types of people to victimize even disabled, mentally handicapped kids in wheelchairs.
Now, remember, now, David, it's funny. You and I, for people who don't know this, you and I share a very interesting parallel. Our development, I mean, I don't know if you want.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we both grew up in Tampa. We went to the same university, exactly, very close to the same time, yeah.
We probably are. I mean, it's just amazing. I was thunderstruck. But I am a loyal alumnus of the Catholic school system. I never saw a kid get hit once. Mm-hmm. When that nun walked in, all 4 feet tall, wearing full penguin regalia, in the hot Tampa, Hillsborough County sun, and not breaking a sweat, in black and cardboard, I never heard of a policeman. Now, years later, David, you might recall, there was something called the school resource officer, or the SRO. This was the officer who kind of would be, hey, David, how are you, Officer Friendly? How are you, Dick? Come on, move along, boys. And it was a slow introduction of a guy who was just kind of there, kind of a well-armed security guard. Not really an assistant to the, all right, but there was a police. Now, what happens is, instead of a police, of a teacher, and by the way, we have two concomitant roles of blame here, two vectors of liability. The police, who could exercise discretion and say, I'm not going to arrest a kid. I'm not going to do this. And the teacher. But David, they're now calling 911. Now, what's interesting to notice, and you brought this up about the UN, to show you how schizophrenic it is. You know, this is learned helplessness. This is classic learned helplessness where you are so beaten down, you can't predict what to do anymore. Classic story of the dog who was given electric shocks so many times that when you open up the pen, it just sits there. It says, I can't even move anymore. But the UN is telling you either you're being too strict and you shouldn't spank your kids and we're going to come after you, or it's okay to be excessive and go after a child, and I don't know how this thing works. So what we're seeing here is the systematic habituation and the conditioning of adults and parents to this thing called authority.
Yeah.
This absolute heartless, mindless, learned helplessness. You know, David, I want you to go through these lists of people and or these conditions of what kids have been basically arrested for. Let me also say this. Let's assume your child has a scrape with the law, so to speak. And let's say your child decides to try to get a job, but your child can't. Your child can't because your child's got a record, got an arrest record.
His permanent record. Going all the way back to kindergarten. That's where they're going to start this, right?
Right. So now you have this over enforcement of this. And again, I want to say, you know, David, we have kids who are drowning in psych meds, who are over medicated, who have very serious emotional and behavioral problems. I was a juvenile prosecutor. That's not a description of my mental wherewithal, but I saw these kids, and more often than not, it was my first look at how the criminal justice system handles mental health. But you're going to turn a kid over, and that kid's going to say, using Pavlovian conditioning, every time I see a cop, every time somebody tells me no, I'm going to remember that. I'm going to remember how they made me feel. I'm going to remember how they laughed at me. I'm going to remember how afraid I was. I remember how nobody was there to protect me. Mm-hmm. I was the ultimate victim of violation. I trusted my teacher, and I don't anymore. I trusted the police, and I don't anymore. I don't trust authority. Nobody's here to help me. I can't depend on anyone. And I'm going to give this back. Somebody's going to pay for this. I mean, if you can't see where this is going.
It's amazing how this has changed over the number of years. I mean, I remember, as we point out, they didn't have police in the schools when you and I were young. Even when my wife was teaching school, they still had the system where they would take somebody away, they would punish them in secret. And we'll talk about that when we come back. What is behind this training camp for the prison industrial state? Stay with us. We'll be right back with Lionel. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and I'm talking to Lionel, an Emmy Award-winning television news decoder. As he puts it, he's an analyst. He's a commentator. Of course, he is also a licensed trial lawyer, former prosecutor. I want to talk to him about an article that's on the New York Times as well. Should prison sentences be based on crimes that haven't been committed yet? We'll get to that topic. But before we do, we've been talking about how schools have changed, how they've become training programs for the police, the prison industrial state, police at all the schools, the over-the-top treatment of our children. At the same time, the UN is saying that it wants to see parents jailed who spank their children. So we're going to go to the extreme against parents, but we're going to allow the most extreme treatment by uniformed personnel that we can imagine in the schools. Do you feel that? That's what Lionel just calls schizophrenic. I call it cognitively dissonant. And boy, I tell you, I think when I see that kind of radical juxtaposition of these things, I think there's an agenda going on here. What about you, Lionel?
Well, I couldn't agree more. First of all, I apologize for saying schizophrenic with all due respect and apologies to schizophrenics out there trying to blaspheme your name. You know, David, there is something where I want you to go back and let's do a thought experiment. You and I are part of the ruling class. We are at the top of the pyramid. And our division is social. I've always said that I've told Alex that I want to be one day the psychologist general. Not the surgeon general, not the attorney general, but the psychologist. I want to construct memes and attitudes and persuasions. But what you and I would do, David, is we'd sit down and we'd say, first of all, our assignment is part of this, call it whatever you want, New World Order or unipolar world or ruling class is what I call it. We're going to destroy family and people. And we're going to make them pliant and compliant. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to destroy parental autonomy. How do we do that? First of all, we tell parents that they can't spank. And I'm not endorsing spanking, but it doesn't really matter. That's not the issue. We're going to tell parents you can't do that. We're going to tell parents they cannot have any say in vaccines or the type of diet or the type of games that your child plays. Maybe dodgeball this week we might consider to be a problem. We're also one day going to go after food. You're going to have them, I'm vegan by choice, but you're going to see them going after parents who elect to have their kids raised vegan, not because they care about the diet of a child. They just want to exert more control.
Mm-hmm.
Then it's going to be circumcision. Watch when that happens, irrespective of religious, anything. Because you see, in our thought experiment, David, it doesn't matter why we're doing this. We want to exact control. And we also want you as a parent to feel that, you know, and I love this. It takes a village.
Yes.
And I love the idea that, yes, we in society share a responsibility to assist, to help when need be. But we do not enjoy our child being part of the collective. As somebody said one time, it takes a village idiot to believe that.
So or as Melissa Harris-Perry said, we've got to get over this notion that there's private ownership of children. You know, when I heard that, one of the things when I hear that, Lionel, and we play that clip all the time, as a parent, I don't think that I own my children. I never thought of it that way. It takes somebody who's running a village to think about ownership of children. I just love my children. It's not about that. And that's one of the reasons why I didn't like to see corporal punishment in the schools. My wife was a teacher in elementary school. One time she had to escort a child because he had been just impossible to handle. She escorted him to the principal's office. The principal spanked the child in front of her. The kid wasn't crying. My wife was hysterical, a basket case. She said, I will never do that again. And really, it's about having someone disciplining your child who loves them, doesn't see them as owning them. And that's right. Another aspect of all this, how the government thinks they own us, how they should track us and control us and categorize us in their permanent record as if we were their inventory, their cattle.
And also, you know, as you know, people are going to say, well, there you go again, Mr. Conspiracy, Mr. Tinfoil Hat, always scared about the government coming after you. Always worried. Who are these people that want your children? Who are? And what I remember going back to our thought experiment, in addition to us having this particular thought vector where we tell people that they have no say, we also bring in people and we applaud them. Like, for example, John Stewart, who was one of the most important parts of this collective, who laughed at people who dared to question Jade Helm, or laughed at people who dared to question. So remember, I hear the music.
And he was also making secret visits to the White House, cooperating with Obama on how to sell Obama's agenda. Let's not forget that as well. When we come back, we're going to be talking to Lionel Media. He's a licensed trial lawyer. We're going to talk to him about prison sentences based on crimes that haven't been committed yet. Stay with us. We'll be right back. I'm talking to Lionel, Emmy Award-winning news decoder, as he puts it. He's an analyst, a commentator, and also a former trial lawyer and prosecutor. I want to talk to him about this article that was on the New York Times yesterday. Should prison sentences be based on crimes that haven't been committed yet? Haven't been committed yet. Pre-crime, minority report. We're going to talk about that real quickly before we get back to Lionel. We have a sale up, a 24-hour sale, a flash sale of DNA Force, 30% off DNA Force for the next 24 hours. It's our most hardcore product from InfoWars Life yet, loaded with BioPQQ compound backed by 175 clinical studies. It contains more potent antioxidant activity than vitamin C. And again, you can get that right now for 30% off for the next 24 hours, a big sale at InfoWarsLife.com. Free shipping through this week for everything at InfoWarsLife.com. Things like Survival Shield X2, which is also in stock. Read the reviews. We have over 400 of them at InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of the respondents would recommend it to a family or friend member. And also we have Silver Bullet. Buy two, get two free. That's 50% off of Silver Bullet. Good time to stock up right now while we have free shipping through this week as a thank you to our supporters. Going back to Lionel, what do you make of this? We're seeing this move towards pre-crime in so many different areas, in so many different ways. I mean, we got we had the NDAA a few years ago where everybody was initially alarmed because they were going to be locking people up with the military without charging anybody of any crime. But now we've got Wesley Clark floating the trial balloons. We've got McCall putting out a violent extremism bill where they're going to have FEMA camps, looking, they're going to have the Department of FEMA under Homeland Security looking at people trying to sort out who may become a problem in the future. Now we see this in Pennsylvania. They're going to be the first state in the country to base criminal sentences not only on what crimes people have been convicted of, but whether they're deemed likely to commit additional crimes.
You know, I know you don't mean to do this, but your delivery kills me. I was listening to you read a real story, and I'm laughing. Larry, the government announced whether you're going to lock people up before they've committed the crime. And you're reading this, and I'm laughing. I'm thinking, this isn't a joke. You know,
it's not a joke. In
2010, I had talked about this, and I believe Alex did as well. The Brits, who's always looked at the UK first, always looked to Europe first. That's the beta test. That's where they figure these things out. That's the laboratory. But they had a system called CRUSH, criminal reduction using statistical help or
hubris.
So what they did was they looked at things that were happening based upon weather and crime to predict where crime was likely to be committed. And I think it makes a lot of sense because if you think, well, based upon the statistic, boy, you guys are good. I just say something and lo and behold, there it is. When the piece is highlighted, it's amazing, your organization. Anyway, it's one thing to say this particular area, Precinct 5, has a high burglary rate and New York did it with ComStat and a variety of other things. Okay, that was terrific. Now that veered into predicting human behavior. Now, again, a while back, you may not remember this one, when sex offenders, rapists and the worst of the worst, were given a sentence. Let's say you're given 25 years to life, and a defendant was sentenced and absolutely did every last day of it. And you could have post-release, no probation or whatever, but they started to say, you know, there are people who, by virtue of what we've learned and their behavior, might continue to commit rape based upon what they've said, I'm going to rape again or what have you. Let's keep them in jail or in prison. And I thought, wait a minute, hold it. No. You can't do that. Either charge them again, wait. I know this is a tough thing. You got to wait until they commit a crime. But people say, oh, you don't understand.
That's a novel idea.
This was real. They said, you don't understand. The recidivism rate is up. Yes, I understand this. And by the way, you're showing this Minority Report. Every time I watch a TV show, I can't believe it. TV show or movie, I'm watching either the future or I'm using it as a reference. My wife and I watch Mayberry all the time and cry because I'm thinking it really was that way. So what's happening is, and let me just explain this. When you train an animal, I'm a psych major. I'm an amateur psychologist and a self-appointed TV expert on virtually any subject. But what happens is you do systematic approximation. When you train your dog or your cat or whatever, you give them a little bit and then a little bit more. And you acclimate. You habituate. You have this sense where that the stimuli are not novel anymore. So we start off with CRUSH in 2010. We start up with another story of keeping people in who are rapists. You don't mind that, do you, America? I mean, after all, you don't want somebody raping your daughter. No, that's okay. And then we add a little bit more. And then we go into terrorists. And then we go into bioreferencing. And then, before you know it, somebody wakes up and says, wait a minute, when did this happen? It happened all along the past couple of years. And when we, the conspiracy theorists, the tinfoil hat lunatics, warned you about this, you didn't listen. You thought this was someplace else. You, in this fog of American exceptionalism, could not believe that something this draconian could actually take place. Yeah. And it does.
Yeah, it's absolutely amazing. And we can go back and we can look at how many nonviolent criminals are that are locked up right now in our prisons. I remember when they started instituting these mandatory minimums under Ronald Reagan, and they were having to let out violent criminals so they could lock up nonviolent pot users. And that was going on for quite some time. They said, don't worry, we'll build a lot more prisons, and they did. And now they have prisons where they have contracts with the government. They have a guaranteed occupation rate. They get prison labor that is heavily subsidized. They have every incentive to keep these people in. You're looking at this from a legal standpoint, Lionel. I'm looking at it as a former computer engineer, and I know that when they're going to use a model to determine if somebody's going to remain in prison or whether they're going to send somebody to prison, I'm very frightened by that. I mean, this is all boils down to, well, how good is their model? You know, we got the garbage in, garbage out, everybody talked about with the computer. Right. I'm not impressed when I see a computer printout. I know a lot of people are. If you get a computer to pop up an answer, then that's it. You know, the answer to life is 42, according to Deep Thought or whatever. But I'm not impressed by that because it all depends on your assumptions and your model. How good is your programming? Who gets to make those assumptions? Which corporations are we going to go with? Are we going to go with the ones that greased the palms of the senators the most, or the ones that have some kind of a, you know, a program that actually works? But all of that skirts those pragmatic decisions that are really troublesome, skirt the whole issue of legality. Do we want to have the presumption of innocence before we put somebody out? Should they actually be convicted of a crime? I mean, this is insane.
You know, I could speak to you forever. Whenever you say something, you inspire a new thought. We have in this country this crazy idea called probable cause, reasonable suspicion, and the like. And it means simply this. If we had it here in New York, stop, question and frisk, and stop and frisk, and Terry, whatever it is. Let's say you and I are in a car, cop car, late at night, and we say, hey, see that guy over there? Yeah, I think he's up to something. Let's go stop him. Wait a minute. Can't do that. We have no reasonable suspicion. Not probable cause, reasonable suspicion. That's what we do in this country. Police can talk to you. We can arrest you. We can convict you. Hell, we can even kill you. But we have to play by the rules. Well, now we're getting rid of that. Here's what happened a while back. DUI checkpoints. Sounds good, doesn't it? I mean, after all, You don't want your daughter to be killed. And they always, you know, David, in trial law, the quickest way to a mistrial is to violate this thing called the golden rule. And it means something like that. How would you feel? How would you feel if this guy broke in here? And you can almost hear it. Mistrial, because you don't talk about objectifying or translating something into this subjective understanding of the crime. No, it's about proof and weighing the proof, not how you feel. But it started with DUI checkpoints, started with drug testing. Come forward, all you people that we've never suspected. Come here, Mr. Knight, have a seat. Yes, would you please mix your aid into this Dixie cup? Why? Well, to disprove something I've never accused you, nor have I ever, ever thought you ever violated. You've never been to work late or stoned or whatever. By the way, all of you in this lane, pull over to disprove that you're not drunk, even though there are no indicia, indications, evidence that you are. It also started with, and today you can forget it, immigration checkpoints. Everybody just be corralled. So little by little, again, more acclimation, more conditioning, more habituation, more getting used to this idea, and more of an acceptance that probable cause, reasonable suspicion, all of these precursors don't really apply anymore. We're going to cut out the middleman. So that's what we're doing also in this scheme of things. And, you know, it's one thing when you are a public carrier, you're a bus driver. And by the way, I've got to say this about drug testing. I never understood something, which is normally a urine test, that detects whether I've come into contact with something 30 days ago, 2 weeks ago. Well, if you're going to do a test of a guy driving a bus, do a blood test. I mean, if you're going to have to. So we have completely eliminated the idea of the police ever having probable cause. By the way, you ever seen this? They pick up the phone. Mr. Knight, yeah. Listen, this is Detective Gil Hooley. We want you to come down to the station. All right, I'll be there. And people do. Come down to the station for what? What is this, an invitation? You're going to buy me lunch? I don't have to do anything you say. Here's one for you. You most probably, and I'm not versed with Texas law, but where I'm from, you can lie all you want to a police officer. What's your name, son? Donald Duck. Where are you from? Oz. Well, that's, you know, it's the breaks. You lie to an FBI agent, and that's what happened to Martha Stewart. Oops, pardon me. That's what happened to Martha Stewart. So why can't I lie? I have the right to remain silent. I'm not under oath. And oh, here we go. Drug dogs. This is a better one. How many people just believe in drug dogs? They just say, don't you? I do. I mean, what do we have next? Clairvoyance and psychics? No, we do that every now and then. So what's
happening? And of course, Lionel, the drug dogs don't even talk. And so the officer is free to interpret any activity of the dog as a positive sign if he so wishes. If the dog wags his tail, then, oh, he finds something in your car that's suspicious, so now let's go in and take a look at it. It's just amazing to, as you're pointing out, the lack of the presumption of even innocence. I mean, it started out really used to be that it was only the IRS where you had to prove that, you know, beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are innocent of doing any of this stuff. Then we move to the drug situation. Now we're moving to the war on terror. And it just, everybody has been conditioned progressively to accept the fact that we don't have any presumption of innocence anymore. It's absolutely amazing. But that's how they move the Overton window.
Well, you know, let me ask you this. You know, when I was a prosecutor, the case, well, what I learned right away was, you know, when you put somebody in prison, you know, jail's bad enough. Don't forget, prison is over a year or over. Jail is up to a year. But when you put somebody in prison, you better hope to God they don't come out worse, which they often do. But here's what I would say. 90%, if I were a judge and I did not have mandatory minimums or sentencing guidelines or three strikes, you're out, habitual felony offenders and all those weird statutes, 9 out of 10 people, with the exception of really serious stuff, I put them on probation. Probation is really effective. Probation is a pain in the arse, as some would say, and it allows you to maintain going to work, you know, maintaining for your family. A lot of times, it really, the amount of recidivism, probation works like a charm, but it's considered to be weak in this country. Now, the people I do, if I were the judge, I take you off of the street, not as a punishment, you know, penal poena from Latin punishment, not that. I take you off the street to protect society. Mm-hmm. You cannot comport. It doesn't teach you. You know, in the old days, David, there was the idea of the penitentiary. Penance. You were penitent. It was the reform school. Mm-hmm. You know, it was penitentiary. We wanted to teach you something, pay your debt to society. You know, the idea is that you would go in and come out better. That is ridiculous. When the sentencing guidelines came along in the 70s or 80s, the first thing they wrote in many of the state statutes was, it is not rehabilitation, that is not our goal. It's punishment. Punishment for what you've done. And what happens is you take people, and after you let them out, they can't get a job, can't get credit, they can't do anything. You've destroyed them.
Yes.
And some do very, very well. So what you're doing is you're creating this new class of citizens. Now, we're also getting into this, which is even more frightening. David, you and I talk about this all the time. And I don't want to sound like some old geezer on the front porch when I was a boy. But there was a time when I remember looking at the police officer as being my friend. Mm-hmm. Norman Rockwell, call it what you want. The guy in your neighborhood. Did you ever have somebody who parked their patrol car down the street? Hey, that's Jimmy Thompson's dad. He's the guy on Sunday who directs traffic after church. It was a community thing. The cop wasn't, there we go. The cop was, look at this. This poor kid, look at this picture. He's running away. He's got the knapsack. And what is this cop doing? He looks like Chris Christie, the cop, if you look at him. He's looking at the kid and he's saying, basically, he's talking him over. Now, you might be a little bit suspicious. I hope they called the parent and told him little Jimmy's okay. But this was the idea.
Today, he would taser him and put him in handcuffs.
He would be drugged up. He'd be on some kind of psychiatric medication in some juvenile home. So And to show you how old I guess I am, remember, I'm so sorry. Remember in years ago, there was a show, SWAT, Special Weapons and Tactics, ABC, when it just became new. We didn't know what a SWAT team was. And all of a sudden, these guys, whenever they would get, Greg Forrest was his name or something, whenever they would have to go to some event, they changed out of their uniform, put on their SWAT military stuff with just a black cap, maybe an automatic weapon, and then changed back. That ain't the way it is. They're RoboCop 24/7.
That's right. Now we have incarceration by algorithm. That's going to be the next thing. Not only the not the presumption of innocence, but incarceration by algorithm. We got one more segment with Lionel Media, and I want to talk when we come back about the presidential race and get your take on that as a news decoder. We'll be right back with Lionel. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Lionel of Lionel Media, an Emmy Award-winning television news decoder, legal analyst. We've been talking about pre-crime. We've been talking about training our children to live in a prison society. That's what I think that they've turned the schools into. This segment, I want to talk to Lionel about his take on the political race, particularly Donald Trump, because as it's pointed out in the LA Times, Trump is a candidate everyone can name, and everyone has a name for him. There's a lot of different reactions on this. Of course, if we looked at the debate that was on in New Hampshire on Monday night, that was the typical kind of snooze fest that we've become accustomed to. It's going to be far more interesting on Thursday night because Donald Trump is going to be there. And I think it's going to be an interesting debate. It remains to be seen if we're going to have anything of any substance, but I think it'll be very entertaining. Lionel, what do you think?
Well, you know, years ago, you might have remembered this. One of my favorite shows on television was SCTV, Second City Television. And there was a character named Vic Hedges who ran for mayor, and his motto was, Vic Hedges, Jerry's crazy. But what if he's right? Well, that's Donald Trump. What if he's right? I, by the way, this is the God's honest truth, every presidential election race, I write in my own name on the ballot. I'm not voting for any of these people. That being said, Donald Trump is fascinating because he's telling the mainstream media, you're not going to determine who's the candidate. You're not going to determine who makes sense, who's smart, who's viable. The people do. And the people, like it or not, I will always err on the side of the popular vote, say we like him. And by the way, he, Bernie Sanders, and Rand Paul, by the way, have some of the most cogent and comprehensive views on how to handle Putin, Russia, and Ukraine, which is a Cold War about to go hot. So in many respects, Donald Trump is my new hero. Because the professional left mainstream media, the John Stewarts and others, can't believe that their dislike means nothing.
Yeah, absolutely. I've seen some things that he's had to say that I agree with in print. He hasn't really articulated a lot of these yet. He might be doing that in the debates as we see this come up. I guess one of my questions, Lionel, about Donald Trump is he's kind of like Picasso. You know, Picasso had a blue period. Yeah. Followed by a rose period. Right. And the same thing with Donald Trump. You know, he had a period where he gave a lot more money to the Democrats. He had his blue period. And then he went into a rose period, a red period about 5 years ago, where he stepped up his contributions and gave almost exclusively to Republicans. So when you go back and you look at PolitiFact, they say, well, that's not true. He's given more money to Republicans than he did to Democrats. That is if you average it over 26 years. But in the last, and that's mainly because the last 5 years, he's really stepped it up.
David, I got to ask this question. Who the hell is PolitiFact? Yeah. Who smokes? Who are these people? They say, I'm a fact. Okay, well, listen, prediction quickly. Hillary's going to drop out. She ain't going to be there. She's not going to be there. I don't know if it's going to be health, emails. She's not going to be there. Once they get the green light, Joe Biden is coming to the fore now because he's already meeting with big Democratic fundraisers, big donors. You've got to get rid of Hillary first. She's gone.
I think so.
Also, Bernie Sanders is the catch basin, the little wheel for the Democratic Party. He's forcing him to go left. And also, Elizabeth Warren, who said, I am not going to run. With Hillary out of the picture, watch what she has to say. So that's not, but Hillary is toast. Absolute. Take this to the bank. I've been saying this forever. It ain't going to happen. And by the way, well, there we are.
I agree. I think that there's plenty of people in the Democrat Party, it's not just Republicans who want to lock her up. They want to lock her out. And they will use all these scandals. I mean, she's got a lot of stuff on her plate. We've been talking to Lionel from Lionel Media. You can find him on Twitter at Lionel Media. Thank you so much for joining us. Join us tonight at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern for